I'm here with the OMTech Polar 350. This is the first CO2 laser that I've had the pleasure of reviewing on this channel. I would like to take a moment to thank OMTech for providing the Polar 350 for review. I am not affiliated or paid by OMTech. All opinions are my own. And with that, we can proceed. So in the past, I've done a lot of reviews of diode lasers of varying degrees of power, the most powerful being 20 watt. The major downside to having something like a diode laser is that you can't really work with clear glitter or mirror acrylic. As a sewist and a bag maker at heart, working with clear acrylic is kind of important because I like to make templates. Unfortunately, you have to get a CO2 laser to do that. Diodes can work with some acrylics like solid black. So in this video, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna review the OMTech Polar 350 from the perspective of someone who is wanting to jump from a diode laser and right into the CO2 pool. Right off the bat, you can see that it's a lot larger than the machines I've reviewed in the past. This is what they would call a desktop laser. I don't know whose desk this is fitting on, but it's not fitting on mine. The working area of this particular laser is 20 inches by 12 inches. So not only is a CO2 laser traditionally larger, it's also heavier. Unlike a diode, a CO2 laser has a tube in it, a glass tube. So because it's a glass tube, it needs a lot more protection. That's why you have a full metal body. All CO2 laser tubes are considered a consumable resource. You will have to replace it after so many hours of use. The Polar 350's tube lifespan is approximately 11,000 hours. The machine's tray can come out and you can see I've already abused it, but this is basically your crumb catcher. And then I can show you how the honeycomb tray slides out. This is important to note because you'll need to remove all of these things if you ever want to use the rotary, which, by the way, the machine comes with two rotaries. It also comes equipped with a 360-degree camera. You'll find it right smack in the middle of the lid. So what software do you need to interact with the OMTech Polar? Well, you probably want to use Lightburn, but it does come with a copy of RDWorks. RDWorks is basically produced by Rowida to help you interact with Rowida controller machines. It's extremely rough to use and there's not really a lot of user-friendly features to it. So if I were you, I would kind of back away from that and consider getting a Lightburn license. As with any laser purchase, as soon as you get it, the first thing you need to do is dial in settings. I'm gonna link a spreadsheet of settings that I used for all of the products and tests that I did in this video in the description below. It'll give you a good starting point. However, you're gonna wanna do tests on your own because every laser is different. You always want to do a material test. These material tests help you identify what power to speed ratio you need to use to get the results that you want. Here you can see the outcome of the material test that I did on wood. And here's the acrylic test. Might be a little hard to see because it's clear. The last test I would encourage you to do is a concentric circle test. Once you've dialed in the settings for what you want as a score line for wood, you need to do this test to ensure that you don't have wobbly lines. A common concern among consumers for basically all caliber of desktop lasers is having wobbly score lines. So while your score lines may look good on the material test, once you take out the concentric circle test, you'll actually find out just how much slower you have to go to get those score lines right if you have curves. These are the results of my concentric circle test. I could probably go as fast as 100 millimeters per second when I'm doing score lines, but there's a little bit of wobble on the outer ring. It was definitely more tolerable down here in the 50 millimeters per second range, and pretty much non-existent once I got to 25 millimeters per second. You could probably go as slow as 20 millimeters per second, but by the time you go any lower than that, you're edging into cut territory. So if you still have wobbles, check the tensions on your belts. Make sure nothing is loose. That goes for the laser head as well, because the laser head actually can be swapped out for a longer focal length laser head, which comes with the machine. Ta-da! So that's enough talking about the machine's highlights. Let's go ahead and do a project using wood.
The wood project is going to be a beautiful wine box. The design is by Laser Artisan Designs on Etsy. I'll leave a link to their shop in the description. The Polar 350 cut the wood like a hot knife through butter. There were no noticeable jitters or jerks in the movement. Everything was fluid. I used variable power so it would slow down when needing to make sharp changes in direction. Since the design had some intricate details, I didn't want to go too fast. I had plenty of wiggle room to crank up the speed and power if I had wanted. Speaking of details, look at how well it cut these tiny holes for the violin's tailpiece. The strings were the most delicate part and could have easily snapped, but they came out great. I mentioned testing concentric circles to make sure the y-axis was operating correctly. As you can see here, there are no issues. The curves on this treble clef are very clean and smooth. Overall, I was very impressed. I finished the wood with a little bit of lacquer and a light sanding before assembling it. This is going to make a great present for my violin teacher.
So let's highlight acrylics. The cool thing about acrylics is that you can start making really neat signs, jewelry, and other home decor projects. Or in my case, sewing templates. I'm going to use this 1/8 inch clear acrylic sheet for making a template right here on this video.
I like to use clear acrylic for my pattern templates because it lets me see the fabric and fussy cut if I want. I used the engraving settings that I preferred from the material test earlier. While you shouldn't score faster than 50 millimeters per second, the Polar 350 has zero issues with engraving at higher speeds. As you can see here, it's doing just fine. The cut is super smooth as well. It's important to point this out because the laser needs to run hot enough to somewhat melt the edges to avoid getting a lumpy looking cut. This is true of all CO2 lasers. The Polar 350 did a great job cutting this acrylic. Now typically CO2 lasers can't mark metals without some kind of aid. OMTech has a black laser marking spray designed specifically for CO2 lasers and stainless steel products. I sprayed it on this small pendant to give it a try. The settings are provided with the spray, so I didn't have to waste any pendants when testing. You typically need to use a high power to trigger the chemical reaction that produces the black markings. The spray is very light, so you can dust it off with your hands or a paper towel once you're done. As long as you have the right settings, it'll never scratch or wear off.
Now that we've done acrylic and wood, let's take a look at how the rotary works. There's no difference in functionality between these two rotaries except for their width. I mean the width between the wheels. Objects with larger diameters are going to go on the rotary that has a 1 on it, whereas all smaller ones go on the rotary with a 2 on it. Those numbers correlate to stickers of equal value inside the machine itself. The added benefit being, of course, there's no second guessing where you put the darn thing.
Installation of the rotary attachment is pretty simple. The machine needs to be powered off so you can move the gantry out of the way to reach the plug. The rotary fits in the open section at the base. Unfortunately, the machine is too short to take advantage of the rotary without using risers. OMTech offers a help article for creating your own risers by gluing several layers of plywood together. There's no official risers that you can purchase at this time.
So now that we've gone over a couple of projects using things and doing things that we otherwise couldn't do with a smaller, less powerful diode laser, let's go into some final thoughts. First off, if you're not mechanically inclined or computer savvy, this might not be for you. You need to use Artyworks or Lightburn, neither of which are beginner friendly. Lightburn does have like a beginner easy mode kind of interface to it. However, it's still a lot to absorb. Second, there is no such thing as a material library or help files or anything for this kind of machine. You're gonna have to do your own tests and come up with your own combination of settings to get the results that you want. That means playing around with it for several days, hours, weeks, whatever time frame you wanna use, to get those settings right before you launch into a project. You're not gonna be able to open this machine up, flip on the switch, and start making things right away unless you have all that information already in your memory bank. So, like I say, you gotta tinker with it a little bit. You might have to tighten the belts. You might have to swap out the lens. You might find that some of the nuts and the bolts are loose when you get it. So, just bear that in mind. I will say, this is the kind of laser that I learned lasering on just 1.5 years ago. And now I have, like, 7 lasers? 7? That's a lot of lasers. Pew pew! You're gonna need a lot of space. This is a 44-inch wide Husky. It's also 24 inches deep, and it's taking up the majority of it. In fact, I wouldn't even be able to fit a filter over here if I wanted to have an air purifier. Which leads me to the other thing. you're gonna have to have some way of venting it. It's also extremely heavy, so once you put it down, it's staying there, which is why I have a table with casters. The other thing to consider is that there's no North American-based support system. The support crew is awesome, and they will respond to you, and they will help you. However, sometimes it can take 24 hours or more to get a response. That's just how time zones work. I don't know what to say. The earth is round. This goes back to my point of saying if you don't have a mechanics mindset or the ability to kind of tinker around with the machine, you might get frustrated because oftentimes the support team is going to have to tell you to loosen things, tighten things, move things around, or even take the machine apart. One big positive that I will give it is the price point. Prices on desktop CO2 lasers are coming down. They're no longer $10,000 or even $5,000 when I first started getting into it. Right now, I believe this one is less than $2,500, which again comes with the two rotaries, all of the exhaust tubing, and the inline fan. Basically comes with everything you need short of materials to get up and running. You can even buy a bundle that comes with a light burn license. If you're okay with everything that I just said and my final thoughts, then absolutely grab this laser. I have thoroughly enjoyed dialing in settings and making these wonderful projects for this video. I just have the added benefit of knowing lasers and how to use them. And if you're patient and you're a beginner, go ahead and hop in. The water's nice. I shouldn't do that. Thank you so much for visiting my corner of the internet. If you have any questions or comments, please don't hesitate to leave them in the section below the video. I'll leave links to helpful articles and tips on how to use this laser and all of the project stuff that I did in this video. Oh, as well as a link to the machine. Thank you so much and goodbye.